Okay. Good morning, everyone, again. Whoever has their speaker on in person, can you switch it off, please? Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. So I hope that everyone was able to upload their data to TopMed yesterday to look at how it processed the data and how it started running. And if you started the downloads, good for you. We know that it takes a really long time to download the files. So we will be providing you with the input files for today so that everyone is on the same page and everyone can practice their global local ancestry inference. But at least now you know how to upload your files to TopMed, what it looks like to process it, and how to download it. By way of hands in person, did anyone get to the post-imputation QC steps? No. Okay. So what I will do is I'll just show you. Well, we have the commands for the post-imputation QC steps. There's two commands on BCF tools. Those are the only two commands that you need to run for your post-imputation QC. Relatively straightforward for allele frequency filter and for the quality score R-squared filter. So once you have done those, your file is ready to take further. It is in a per chromosome format. So the only thing that you would need to do in order to start with the global and local ancestry inference is to put the per chromosome files into one file. And that is done using a process called concatenation. So I'm highlighting now in my terminal the process for concatenating the files. So you use the function vcf-concat. This is a Perl script in the software VCF tools. You will use this and it will create a single file with all your chromosomes that have obviously been, you've done your pre-imputation QC. So this file is now ready to go. So once you have this file, you will then take it a step further, and that is what Yolandi is going to walk us through today. But before Yolandi takes over, I would just like to give everyone opportunity to either post in the chat or in person any issues, any problems, any queries that you have from any work yesterday, any specifically relating to TopMed or anything else. Yes. Yeah. So if it was giving you an error when you were uploading regarding the number of files, then what I would recommend is actually just deleting. If you had uploaded any files, is just deleting the files in that block in TopMed and starting again. And make sure when your file browser pops up that you make sure that you select the 22 chromosomes. So if it didn't pick up 22 chromosomes and it gave you an error after uploading it, then one or two of your files were probably corrupt and you would need to just look at which ones those were and just maybe go back a step and redo the last step. So it's probably got to do with that the file didn't finish processing or something strange happened. In bioinformatics, things like that unfortunately happen. I'm sure you know. Anyone online with any issues, any problems? You'll notice as well is that there are two polls in the chat. One just so that we can get feedback regarding the workshop and improve any other workshops that we do. And the second poll is we would like to know what workshops you would like to do that follow on from this one. So we are thinking about doing another workshop, taking the knowledge that we have learned in this workshop, taking it forward. So we could do a GWAS workshop, a polygenic risk score workshop, a workshop on selection scans, so identifying signals of natural selection in a population, or admixture mapping. So please fill in that poll, and based on that poll, we will be offering whatever topic is the top hits. And then as well, please fill in the workshop, the feedback, so that we can improve in any way the workshop itself. Yes. Okay, will you chat to Devin? Will you just check the first poll, please? Okay. I see there's a comment. Sean, we will definitely make all the recordings available from yesterday and today, as well as all the slides and all the cheat sheets. That will all be posted on the OneDrive folder. Obviously, the recordings we'll post at the end of today, both of them. In the OneDrive as well, there is the input file for today. So that file name, just so that you have the correct one, there are six. So I'm going to let Yolandi do that. So she will post the file names in the chat of the files that you need to download from the OneDrive folder. Again, if you don't have the OneDrive folder, if you don't have the ones from the OneDrive folder, if you don't have access to the OneDrive folder, please post your email address so that we can give you access. If you are external from Stellenbosch, we need to put in your email address to give you access. So please do that. As I said, all the videos yesterday and today, I know yesterday's is not online on OneDrive. We need to edit it before we post it online. Otherwise, it will be too large and too long. So we will post both videos either at the end of today or Monday at the latest. Okay, I'm going to stop sharing and hand over to Yolandi, who will take us through the global and local ancestry inference. Thanks.
Okay, sorry, guys. So I hope everyone can hear me. If you can't, just shout. So today I will be talking about global and local ancestry inference and actually tell you why you've been actually doing some very extensive QC with your Plink files and actually make some beautiful pictures with it. So first I'm going to discuss why you want to use it and then exactly what global and local ancestry is and which software we're going to use for that as well. So first, why do we want to use ancestry inference? So first that you need to understand is this is a statistical procedure. So we're using algorithms and statistics to take your data, map it to the reference, and actually infer some population structure. So one of the main things we do is to see how much different your population or cohort you want to investigate is from other populations. So basically comparing the allele frequencies to each other. And then also you can do some migration studies as well. And then mostly what we also do in genome-wide association studies is use this population structure you inferred to actually adjust for the confounding factor of ancestry. So here I made some pictures of three individuals, A, B, and C. You can phenotypically on the outside look exactly the same. But if you look at your chromosomes, you can actually have very different ancestries contributing that to that specific chromosomes. So when we do a case control study, usually, and you want to identify, for instance, a genetic region that are associated with the disease phenotype, it could actually be due to the ancestry at that genetic region and not due to the actual disease-causing variant. So that's why we need to adjust for population structure in genome-wide association studies. And then we can also do local ancestry inference, which is basically identifying each genetic region and painting it a specific ancestry. So you also, we usually use that in admixture mapping. So where you take the local ancestry and just investigate if a specific ancestry is associated with a specific disease phenotype or phenotype of interest. So there's just the main kind of reasons why you would want to do ancestry inference. So this looks kind of like a mess, but this is two individuals representing two chromosomes. And it's very important to remember that with admixed individuals, where you have multiple ancestries contributing to your genome, that there's both the LD haplotype blocks, which is now indicated in a red square, and then you also have your ancestral LD blocks, which is the black, indicated in a black box. So usually when we do genotyping or microarray data analysis, we use tagging SNPs, and this is also basically tagged in an LD haplotype block. So what happens is now you have two different microarrays and it's tagging different SNPs and different ancestral LD blocks. So the disease-causing variant can be basically indicated in red. So both are have exactly the same disease-causing variant, which is indicated in the red, but both of them with the star have a different ancestry LD block in the tagging SNP. So it means like in the one individual, it would pick up the signal, and in the other individual, it would not pick up that signal. So that's why it's so important to do local ancestry inference of each genetic region, because these different kind of ancestral LD haplotype blocks messes up the signal. Or like I said, you can make an association with the ancestry instead of with the actual disease causing variant. So that's why it's so important to do each specific genetic region. So what is global ancestry inference? Usually you see this very beautiful pictures and you're like, okay, what does this mean? So this is just the average ancestral proportion across all the chromosomes based on the allele frequency differences between your populations. So each color basically represents a different population. So for instance, green is the Europeans, the blue is Asian, the red is African, the purple is Nama, and then the orange is Malayan. So as you can see, we have an example here of a five-way admix population from South Africa. And as you can see, each specific horizontal, or not horizontal, vertical line represents one individual. So each individual have a different composition of different ancestry. So overall, we can say, okay, most of these populations are 35 to 40% Khoisan, they're 20% European, but you don't know exactly where this European ancestry or where this Khoisan ancestry in the region is. So this is just giving you an overall overview of what your population structure looks like. And usually we, like I said, we use this global ancestry proportions to adjust for the confounding effect of genetic ancestry in your genome-wide association study. So you need to control for this in your studies. So how do we calculate this? So we're going to use a software admixture. I know there's a lot of other software out there to do that. Like previously we used Structure, but admixture is pretty robust. This basically uses a maximum likelihood approach. So it's basically taking your population's genotype information, mapping it to the reference populations you include in your merged QC file. And it's basically seeing, okay, it's most of the times it maps against this reference. And it takes the next person, it most of the time maps against this reference. So that's how it gets the probabilities of actually calculating this ancestry. So like I said, the input files, you're using the Plinc formatted input files we used. And this is basically, like I said, a set of genetic markers that are informative. So that's why we needed to have that intersecting SNPs between the populations, because otherwise how it's supposed to map against a reference if it doesn't even have the SNPs in common. So that's why the initial QC steps are so important, and you need to have both the ancestral populations and your target population in the same file. So this is kind of the input you're giving admixture. So just a stepwise, how we're going to do this. So we have our genotype quality controlled filtered Plinc format, and then we check and exclude related individuals with King software. King is better to adjust for admix populations than Plinc. So it uses a different kind of algorithm that we can incorporate admixed individuals, because the LD and ancestral LD haplotype blocks is kind of different than just using IBD sections, interbreeding, looking at that specific segments. So that's why we need to exclude them for admixture analysis. We are going to use RFMix, which is other software to actually calculate the global ancestry proportions, and that software can take related individuals. But it's very important to know that we're going to first use admixture to kind of see how many ancestral populations contributes to your population. So if you're looking at a population, but you basically don't know which kind of references to include, I mean, this is the main problem we have. How do we choose how many reference populations to include, which ones actually contribute to your target cohort? So that's why you run it most of the time in an unsupervised manner. So the next step will be to do LD pruning. So this is basically linkage disequilibrium pruning. So what it means is you're just going to take all those SNPs that are in tight linkage with each other and discard the rest of the SNPs. So this is just to make it computational easier because it's quite a computational intensive process. So you're just keeping all those SNPs which are tight in linkage with each other, and there's mostly inherited from the reference populations. And then we're going to run the admixture software. So like I said, you can first run it in an unsupervised manner where we don't assume any number of ancestral populations. So you run it for a multiple numbers of K, which is basically saying the number of ancestral populations. So for instance, you indicate you want to see if 2 to 8 populations are basically contributing to your population. And then we have the supervised manner. So if you already know, okay, this is a 5-way admix population, we know 5 ancestors are contributing to this population, you just indicate K equals 5. And this is basically, if you look at previous literature and you're not very certain, that this is how our cohort looks like. But like I said, the unsupervised manner is basically the best one, because through cross-validation, you can actually see what is the best value of K, which indicates the number of ancestral populations. So the output you get from admixture is Q matrices, which I will show to you now. And that we use as an input to visualize this global ancestry plots with Pong. So this is our admixture output. So the Q matrices, like I said, is better known as ancestry coefficients. So this is basically the file here in the right-hand side. So each column is basically one population. So here you can see this is a 3-way or K equals 3 population with the ancestry coefficients just for each individual indicated. So this is basically what is used to make this figure. It's kind of like taking each horizontal line and plotting it vertically. So then in the log files you get as an output, you will get the CV value. So the lowest CV or cross-validation value is basically the one you're interested in and indicating that is the number of K or K ancestral populations that you require for your population. So this is also the Pong software. It uses basically, it produces a scalable vector graphic, which is very nice. And also you use your representative Q matrix for the major mode for each value of K. So sometimes we also run this admixture multiple times. So you run it 5 times just to make sure in random seeds, just to make sure, okay, what the output you're getting is correct. So that's what's nice about Pong, which other software or kind of module can't do, is actually visualize this different runs and major and minor modes of K. But I will also visually show you this. And I also included the link to this specific GitHub page. But I think if I'm going to show it and illustrate it, it will get very clear. And sometimes you do need to have a Conda environment installed on your laptop to be able to run Pong. So that's why this is a short presentation, because the implementation is rather much more important than actually just talking about it, because working with the data itself and actually visualizing it, you will start getting to know this. So yeah, this is basically what global ancestry is. And I'm going to start with a demonstration of how to actually to start with your Plink input files and then do all this LD pruning, and then also run admixture and then visualize with Pong. It's not going out there. Oh, yes. And if anyone has any questions in regards to this, just let me know in the chat. Just want to quickly increase my screen for you. Oh, why is this not working sufficiently? This mouse is not fine. Okay, so first of all, I just we're going to start off. I don't know if everyone have access to the OneDrive folder and just downloading the files. It is this merged files QC. I've also put it in the chat. So for this, just for presentation, we're not going to actually remove the related individuals with King, just because the King software is a little bit difficult to build on different laptops. So we've already removed that related individuals, and usually we do second degree relatedness and remove that individuals. The reason why we need to remove related individuals is because they share IBD sections with each other. So that, because admixture mapping and ancestry inference is based off of ALD structures and linkage disequilibrium, you basically take your ALD haplotype blocks and actually map that against the reference. So if you have related individuals, it is basically seeing it as one individual. So that's why we need to exclude it for admixture. So first step, what we're going to do. Oh, yes. Yes, it's definitely going to be easier. Do I have both screens on? Sorry, guys. Okay, so the first step is we're going to do ALD pruning. So this is, we're going to use Plink for this. So I'm just going to go where I downloaded my link, basically. Oh, there's the chat. Do you remove both individuals? I'll be on the one. Okay. So once again, we call on Plink. The B files that we want to include is this merged ones that we did post QC on. So first of all, I should have said this first. So you've downloaded now, for instance, your VCF files from the imputation server. You've did the post QC on them. Then you convert the VCF files back to the Plink format. You can use Plink or VCF tools to do that. That's a pretty very straightforward command. And then you do have your Plink files, like I said, now. And then we're going to do the ALD pruning now. Just want to make sure. Independent pairwise, the parameters we're going to use for that. So the actual command is independent pairwise. And you can also get all these commands of Plink also on their manual. So if you ever struggle or find yourself that you don't know what to do, you just go to the Plink manual online, and then you will have a lot of different commands showing you this. So the parameters we're going to use is we're going to indicate a 50 window size. We're going to look at every 20 SNPs, and then we're going to look at the, or we're going to give it a R square threshold of 0.2. So this is basically just you're indicating the window, how many SNPs you're going to look at, which are in tight linkage, and you're going to use the R square value to actually indicate kind of how stringent your R-square value of linkage should be. So for now, we're doing a very relaxed one because we already have so few SNPs. So the thing is, the more SNPs you have, so if you have whole genome sequencing data, or if you have, if you have whole genome sequencing data, you're going to have a lot of SNPs. So you're going to have, so you want to ALD prune then pretty tightly to remove most of the SNPs or variants. So this is kind of the filter we're going to use, and then we're going to see. Yes, now we run the command. So now we can see that you pruned basically 4754 variants from chromosome 1, and then for each chromosome, it removed certain SNPs that were not in tight linkage with each other. So this is kind of the how it did it. So for each 50 window size, we took 20 SNPs at a time, and we had an R-square threshold of 0.2. So this is kind of like you also can play around with these parameters based on your cohort or your kind of question you want to answer, if you have whole genome sequencing data or array data, and how many variants you're losing. So you don't want to lose too many variants in this instance. So if we're going to look at our kind of prune data, pruning completed, and we've lost 68,000 variants of the 300 initial, about 300,000 initial variants. So this is quite not too bad. So That would be 286,000 would be informative enough for us to actually see the population structure between the populations. Like I said, this is just a parameter you choose. You can use the default. You always start with the default parameters, and then from there on you adjust and see how many variants you're losing and how many variants you actually want to include based off of the results you're getting. So now we know that there's the number of variants are actually written in this prune in file. So this is the output files you will get. If you open up this file, you will see this is just the list of all the SNPs now that's being removed, or SNPs, or the prune in data is kind of what you wanna keep. So for now, oops, wrong one. Just want to make sure. Yeah, prune in one. So basically, what we're going to do now is you're going to just keep this pruned in data out of your data set. So once again, we're going to call on Plink. So we're going to use the merge data set. Once again, indicating this is the file we're using. And now we just want to extract the pruned in data. Pruned in. And we're going to basically call it pruned. And there you can see now we've run and just included those pruned in data set. So if we kind of look at what the log file actually told us, now we can see the total genotyping rate is still very good, almost 99%. And then you can see the amount of variants. Now we have 280,000 variants, and the 80 people passed the filters in QC. So this is a good indication. So now we can see there we have our merged file post QC. Like I said, we already removed the related individuals just for ease of this lecture. And then we have our prune data. So this is kind of the files you're going to use for admixture mapping. Okay, so now we're going to run the admixture software. So I hope you all kind of downloaded the admixture software. If you're not, we will give some time for that as well. So because I'm going to run admixture in an unsupervised manner, I'm going to create also a for loop. So I'm going to for loop it through from 2 to 5. So indicating I want to see if 2 to 5, which of those individuals of 2, 3, 4, or 5 ancestral populations contributed to our cohort. So start typing that. So we're going to do admixture. So this is just where I saved my admixture software. And very important is this CV flag. So this is basically indicating our cross-validation. So what we're basically saying for admixture is we wanted to generate this cross-validation value for us to see actually which contributing K ancestral population is the best to use. So that's very important. And the input file is this bed file or the binary file that you can't basically open or see. Oh, come now. Bed file. Just want to make sure. Okay, and the next parameter is basically, this is indicating the K value. Like I said, because we're creating a for loop, you're just indicating that it's basically first it's going to do 2, and then it's going to do 3, and then it's going to do 4, and then it's going to do 5. So that's basically what that variable stands for. Then just make sure. Just for computational ease, we're going to also say, okay, we wanted to run on 4 threads, but usually the thing is we have very small data sets now working. So that's why we can actually run it on our laptop. But if you're going to run it on a server, and it's huge files, you would want it to run on multiple threads. So just to make this computational easier. So, and then we're also going to do is just we're going to get an output in our log files that we would just want to indicate. Yeah. So that we can get the cross validation. Okay. And so this is basically, as you can see, the pruned in bed file. And we're going to run admixture. We've indicated the cross-validation. And now let's see if it starts running. Yes, now we can see now admixture is running. This is a good sign. So now you can see now it starts doing the cross-validation maximum likelihood. And this most probably is going to take a while. So that's why I said I would rather want you to work with the data itself so that you can start and see how this is start running. So if I open up another kind of window here, we go into the specific. Folder that we're making this now, you will see that. It's busy making the Q matrices. So here we can see it already made the log file for this for K equals 2. So there you can see it just giving you the output already as it is, the admixture is running. So this is usually what we run in the background on a server. So this is just showing you this is actually performing it now. This would go quite quickly for now because you're running it on a very small file. And once you do have the outputs, I did make some outputs already. So what you're looking for is this specific Q matrices. So this is kind of how it looks like if you're going to open up the file. So this is kind of the files you would like to start seeing being made as the software is running. So now you can see there's only two populations. So we're seeing the ancestry, basically coefficients for all your populations in two columns. So for each individual, we have the ancestry kind of coefficients for those two individuals. And then we also have the other file that's also being made by admixture. And this is the just, I think it's the pedigree one or paternity one. The probability, yes, I wanted to say that. What's the probability of each of your SNPs being actually the same as the reference? So what we're going to use to visualize is actually these Q matrices that you see or that's being made. And then we're going to use Bonk to visualize that. So for now, what I want you to do is rather start working it on yourself and let admixture start running so you can become sufficient in that and see actually how it's being made. So like I said, for now, we're not going to use King just because it's going to be a mess to download for most people. And then you're going to use that merged file that's been uploaded onto OneDrive. And then you're going to start doing the LD pruning. And maybe if you want to, you can play around with the parameters and actually see if you change that R square threshold of 0.5, you can actually make it 0.1, 0.2 and see actually how many variants you're starting to lose. So you can actually see the difference it makes to change the parameters as well. So I will also post it in the chat what each step is that you're going to do now. But first of all, you're going to take the merge file. You're going to do the LD pruning. You're going to take the LD prune file, the bed file, and start running admixture now. So now we can see in the background, it's basically finished running for K equals 2. And the CV error is basically going to be outputted just about now. We will wait for that. But yeah, so that's what I want you to do now. I will also put the steps in the chat. And then after everyone has their Q matrices, I want us to use also Bong. So maybe try to download admixture and Bong. And then we will start, once you have all the Q matrices, we will start running Bong and actually visualize that as well. Here we go. So now we can see it finished for K equals 2. And there we have our first CV error. So now it started running for K equals 3. That's why we wrote the for loop. So now it started to run for the second K value, which is 3. So yes. Okay, so yeah, we will be, we will do or give you a chance to do this until 10:15 to get the admixture running with this merge files or the Q matrices, and then we will start visualizing that with Bong. So yes, and then we will be here if you have any questions or any other, yeah. Crystal, you had a question. So this is basically the CV error is the cross-validation error. So it's basically taking all the probabilities of all the different K values and actually seeing which one is most likely the best one. Because obviously it takes all the different runs or the maximum likelihood probabilities and see which one is basically performing the best. Yes. No, you take the lowest CV. Yes, the lowest cross-validation error. Yes. Okay. Okay, so I can go, but yes, so I will post all the commands in the chat right now so that you can start doing that. Okay, everyone, I'm going to start again. Sorry, I just want to get to the part where we left off. If you struggled with the admixture, we will give some additional time later, but we need to continue with this. And if you do get an error, you start running admixture and it starts running and it just abruptly stops, it just means that your laptop might not have enough space to make the intermediate files actually to complete the admixture run. So that's why I said you usually use a server if you have very large files. So we will be uploading the Q-matrix files for the next step for actually visualizing with Bong so that everyone can actually just practice doing it. So the whole point about bioinformatics is you need to know how to run the software, work with the data itself. So that's why we want you to actually have the correct files and actually run this yourself, because if you see what you're doing, you're actually understanding what you're doing as well. So please, please try and do it. So this is just an example now of some of the Q matrices, the output we do get if we're going to visualize it with Bong. So here we can see this is, we run it for K equals 2 to 4. So we want to see actually how many populations contributed to this Gambian population. So in blue, we have European ancestry. In red, we have the African ancestry. And in green, we have the green and the red actually separates Kenya and Nigerian ancestry from one another. So first, we can see K equals 2. So we can see there's a little bit of admixture of blue with the red, but not much. And then if you look at three populations, then you can start seeing that, there is some actual West African with the Nigerian, but it's like, do we really expect to see that? No, we're not. So that's why if you do get an output, it needs to make sense. So now we're looking at K4, and now all of a sudden you get this weird purple color as well. So this is just a random population. So that's why I said it's so super important to have that cross-validation error and actually looking at that value or file. And then, like I said, we know that they're actually just mostly homogeneous populations, so that's what we expect to see. So if you look at the admix proportions, you will see it's mostly red, and then there's a few individuals that have a little bit of European admixture, which is quite normal because there was some migration occurring. So like I said, you need to look at previous literature and actually examine, does your results make sense? So to give a little example of a little bit of more groups we can get. So now here is a lot of different, 11 different populations from completely different like African populations, and then some French and Han Chinese as well. So now you can see that there's multiple colors, multiple admixture. So this is kind of the kind of plot you can generate with admixture and with the Pong. So that's why I said like it's very important to include the correct reference populations with your target population. So this is just a nice visual representation. And like I said, you can also run admixture multiple times for the K values, then you have different runs. So you can run it 5 times, then you have 5 runs, or you can run it 10 times, then you have 10 runs, just to make sure that the results you do get is accurate. So now you're asking yourself, okay, what is the difference between global ancestry proportions and PCA plots? Because if you look at previous literature, you will know that a lot of people use principal components to also adjust for population structure. So here we do have a plot of showing a difference between the African populations and the PC1 versus PC2, and then the PC3 versus PC4. So the ultimate goal of a principal component analysis is to see if my data separates. And That's it. It doesn't say to you what is principal component one or two or three or four or five. It just says something is separating your data. So this is a very nice way of first looking at your data. Is my data separating? Is there some structure? This is just saying to you, yes, if you look at the first APCA plot, yes, there's like this little black dots, which is indicating European, and the rest of the dots is African. So we can see, yes, there is definitely a separation between the two of those kind of populations, but it doesn't say how much. It doesn't give you a proportion. So it's just saying to you that it's separating. So that's why people usually do this first, but it is kind of insufficient to use PC components to actually adjust for global ancestry. So I would not recommend doing it, although other people are doing it, because you don't know if PC2 might be age or gender separating your data. So that's why I would just be cautious to do that. So this is just to clear up any confusion. Some people use PCs, some people use global ancestry proportions. Like I said, principal component analysis is just showing you your data is separating. There is some points that are clustering together. There are some points that are not clustering together. So be cautious. So yes, we're gonna do the local ancestry inference this afternoon. So I'm just gonna show you now how Pong works and how we're gonna actually visualize this Q matrices, and it's kind of cool. Okay, get to that. And does anyone have questions as far? So usually iterations, I will say 10 times, just to be safe. I mean, if you're going to run it in any way, make sure you iterate it enough and make sure you actually indicate a random seed number every time you do that as well. So just to make sure that it's not using the same data the whole time. So it's just what it means is just it makes it uses the same data just on different time points. It's rerunning it. Is that good? Yes. Yes. Yeah. So you just you can make a for loop if you want to, or you can just run it 10 times. Yes. Just want to make sure that works.
There's a question online.
Is it okay? How am I gonna scroll down there?
Just go on your Teams.
Sorry, I just want to quickly see in the chat. So I will be sharing this Q matrices on a OneDrive folder with you so that you can actually have the Pong or the files to do this. So now, there are three input files that you do need for Pong to be visualized, because you need to actually tell it what's the order of your populations, which population IDs represents which ancestral population. So if we're going to first, the first file you do need is a file map file. So the first one, it's basically indicating for in the first column, you for K2 for run one, you have two populations and then the file path to your Q matrix file. So that's why this is very important to indicate actually the path to your specific Q matrix file. So if you don't specify the path correctly, it's not going to visualize. And it's a tab delimited file. So it's important that it needs to look specifically like this. These three files will also be uploaded on the OneDrive folder, so you can also download it from there. But it's just for future. This is kind of how you indicate the different K values and the different runs. So if you run it 10 times, you need to actually do it 10 times, indicating to it. So your K numbers, K2 till 5 for run one, we've only run it once. So that's why we only have run one. The next file is basically an individual to pop file. So this is basically the order of your PLINK FAM file. So this is basically just indicating each ID, family ID, that HGDP and a number, that specific number, and then what ancestry that specific individual are. So exactly in order of your FAM file. So, and you can name it anything you want. There should not be any spaces between the names. So it just should be one solid name with no spaces or syntax in between. So this is, it should be exactly the same word count or number of individuals as your FAM file. And it needs to be exactly correct for that specific individual where you got your data from the Human Genome Diversity Project that we got it from. So if you do indicate this individual's wrong, your whole plot is going to look funky. So if you do get a plot that looks weird and you're not expecting something like that, then most probably you use the wrong labels for the wrong individuals. So that's why it's super important. And then this is just if you want to do a population order. So it's just telling you plot it in this specific order. So you have all the different populations and now you're going to plot it differently. So first of all, we're going to call on Pong. So I did upload the link in the chat to download Pong as well. So first you indicate Pong, call on that. Then we're going to indicate the file map with an M. And then the individual to pop with an I. And then the population order with N. So what's going to happen next, it's going to start running. There it started running. And now you can see you're going to use a web interface to basically visualize this. So now it ran. So you're going to take this URL here and you're going to put it into your web browser, whatever web browser you are using. Oh, this is. So there you paste it. Boom, there we got it now. So this is what's so nice about this Pong visualization. Very easy. So now we can see for K2, K3, K4, K5. And at the bottom, you can see the different ancestries or the different populations you included. And yeah, it's even cooler because if you can click on it, it will only show you the blue ancestry. So now you can see and start making sense how many individuals just have blue ancestry. You can zoom in, zoom out. It gives you the average. And then you can also save this, like I said, as a scalar vector. So you have a high quality plot or plot that you can actually get ready for publication. So like I said, you can download the bar plots and then you can have a PNG, a CBG, so high quality. So if we're going to look at actually the results, and is this what we expect to see in our population? So for K equals 2, we already see that the French or European ancestry is separating from the rest of the African sample. So that's a good indication. So then the first for three populations, we already see that the Khoisan now in the green is now basically separating from the rest. And then for four populations, we're already seeing now that the Mabuti go down. That this basically Mabuti pygmy and Biaka pygmy is basically also now separating from the rest of them. And then K equals 5. So now that's why it's so super important to actually go and look at your cross-validation error to see actually which of these K values are the correct contributing ancestries. So that's why I actually want everyone to do this and tell me which one is the correct one so that I know that you did it. Okay. Otherwise, I will also tell you, but it would be nice if you get some participation as well, because otherwise you're just doing this without thinking about it. So yeah, we will upload the key matrices, all the other three files indicating the different names. And my suggestion would be, so maybe play around with it. So let's see if we, for instance, change the pop this individual to pop file. And you change two of these individuals around, and then you start seeing weird things on your plot. So like I said, if you do have the data, we have the example files. Start playing around with it and mess a little bit with it. So you have the right files, and then you do it wrongly, and then you see how wrong it looks. So I will also maybe do that. And then, oh, I see Maria's hand is up. If you still do have a question. So, like I said, for each, that's why it's so super important to just label your individuals correctly and get the correct output. So, yes, I don't know how long we're going to give them. Okay, so the plan is now that you can start running the bong. You have all the key matrices, but we're going to give you time until one. So after lunch to basically get all the files ready, get the key matrices, get the bong output, get to visualize, play around with it, make funky plots if you want to. That's the exciting part about having this data is you can actually play around and see what difference it makes. So then we will also be available online for any questions. And if you are struggling, like I said, if admixture is running on your computer and it just abruptly stops, it is a segmentation error. Like I said, it's most probably because you don't have enough space on your laptop to actually generate this. So that's why we also recommend that you usually use a server to run admixture on your specific data, because this data is very, very small compared to the actual genotype data. So and like I said, up until one, we give everyone a chance to kind of generate these files, the key matrices, the Pong output, look at the CV error, and decide which K value is the best one for this population. Okay. Okay, everyone, we will be starting now. Okay, so now we will start with the local ancestry before we go back to the files again. I just want to explain now first what is the local ancestry and then go to the files again. So what is local ancestry? So it's basically determining every single ancestral origin of every region of the genome. So you're actually getting the number of inherited alleles from each ancestral populations at a particular locus. So either naught, one, or two. So you're either have the ancestral allele, then you're naught, or you're heterozygote, then you just have one, or you're basically homozygote for the ancestral population, then you're two. So this is basically how we incorporate local ancestry into statistical models, is you code it either naught, one, or two, naught being homozygote for not the ancestry, one being you have one allele from the ancestry of interest and one of your own, and then two if you basically have both from the ancestry of interest. So you're painting basically every region of a chromosome a particular ancestry. I'm so sorry, I realized I was muted. So sorry for the in-house people. We will start again. If we can go back. Well, my back button doesn't want to work. Okay, so sorry for the online guys. We will start from scratch again. So, okay, from the currygrams. Okay, so we can see that this basically local ancestry varies across the genome and even between individuals. So you can have the same global ancestry proportions, but the specific region of that ancestry could be different for these two individuals. And also, the size of the ancestral ALDE haplotype block also indicates the time of admixture that occurred. So the longer the haplotype block, the sooner the admixture occurred. And also the smaller the ALDE block, the further back the migration or the admixture occurred. So there's also another additional kind of thing you can calculate from local ancestry is when this kind of admixture occurred. And then you can see and see where migration routes might have taken place. So that's also another interesting application of local ancestry. So how do we perform this? We use the software ArfMix, and it basically determines the likelihood that a region of an individual's genome originates from a particular ancestral population. So how it does this is use the algorithm uses random forest trees to match your reference and your target SNPs from each other. So it takes basically every single SNP in your cohort or your target population, and then it maps it to each specific SNP in the reference, and it starts building like this trees and seeing, okay, it matched the most to the one reference compared to the other one. So that's kind of like how it gets its posterior probabilities in the end. So it matched the most to the one specific reference, so it's most likely from that specific ancestry. So it's just like how the back end of this algorithm basically work. And the phasing is very important for this, where you actually determine the haplotype from the mother and one from the father. So that's basically why you also imputed and phased with TopMed. So likely TopMed already did the imputation and also the phasing. Usually we phase with Shaper2, and we use a recombination map to actually infer those recombination switch points between kind of where it switched from the one ancestry to the other ancestry. So after you phase the data, you have a query VCF file containing the genotypes of your target population. And then you also have your reference VCF file containing the reference genotype data that you're going to map against. And then you're going to have a sample map indicating basically which individuals are your reference individuals and which are your kind of admixed population. And then also your genetic map also indicating the chromosome, the genetic positions, and the switch points basically. So this is basically just showing you how in the ArfMix software, this is basically your admix genome or chromosome with the dot indicating the SNP. And now it matches against the one reference panel, matched against the other reference panel. And like you can see, it starts like building a tree once it starts to map. So this is just kind of showing you nicely how in the end you get a probability for that specific SNP. How probable is it that your specific SNP in your admix population actually map to which reference panel or population? So that's why I said the input data is very, very important. So the choice of your reference populations actually determine the output of your local ancestry. So if you're going to give it garbage, you're going to get garbage out. So that's why it's so important to first do your admixture analysis, do your K values, get your cross-validation error, know which populations actually contribute to your kind of target population. Otherwise, you're just doing redundant work and you're actually not getting an answer. So just to give brief steps. So if you do have a genotype link format, you convert it back to a VCF file. Then you split the VCF file into references and target populations. And you also want to split it into chromosome 1 and 22 to do it separately. And then also you run ArfMix with default parameters sometimes, but then you do get an output. You get four specific output files. So the first one is also a Q matrix that's calculating you the global ancestry proportion. So you can also use ArfMix to get the global ancestry proportions. And we do recommend to use ArfMix output global ancestry proportions rather than admixture, just because it's a little bit more accurate because it uses random forest trees to train the data. And then the file we're interested in is this MSB-TSV file, which is basically giving you the most likely assignment of your subpopulation per CRV point. So I will show you how that file looks like, but there is also a very nice GitHub page explaining all the commands, all the files, all the input and output files. And then after we got this four output files, we take the MSP file and collapse it into two bed files, one allele to represent the one maternal haplotype or allele, and the other one to represent your paternal one. And then you basically use a Python script to visualize the karyograms. So this is just to show kind of how the MSP file looks like. So first, in the first row, you can see this is chromosome 7. It's the start position, end position, and this also indicates how many SNPs have the same kind of ancestry. Then it starts with the one allele from the one individual and the other allele from the other individual. And basically, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 represents different reference populations. So now you can clearly see that for the first individuals, this 4 and 2, it's already heterozygote for the specific ancestry. So the one allele, they have a 4, which is basically Malay, and a 2, which is basically Isan, which is African. So they already have for that first position heterozygote for a specific ancestry. So we use this information and then collapse it into bed files in a bed format to actually visualize it in and plot the karyograms that I've previously shown. And the problem we do have currently is there is no software out there that can plot five-way admix populations. It can infer the ancestry of any kind of five-way, six-way, four-way. It can do the ancestry inference, but there's no software out there that can actually plot it. So most of the software is written for two-way or three-way admix population, but not more than that. So we kind of customized our scripts to do this. So if you're trying to do this on your own and use your own data, you might need to actually just customize your own script to actually plot the results. So we use a script specifically to do this, but you will need to tweak it a little bit to be able to plot your specific data. So to just give a quick recap as to why we do all this, ancestry inference, global, local, and just how you kind of run the analysis, is you did your initial merging and QC steps, which is very, very, very important for downstream analysis, as you can see. And then it's very important to calculate and exclude your related individuals if you do your initial kind of investigation for your population structure. So then you infer the global ancestry, and actually you need to do LD pruning just to make sure that it's computational easier to investigate the population structure. You run the admixture, and then you visualize your results. So some of the scripts is also on our TBOS Genetics GitHub page, where you can find a lot of the scripts and some additional kind of tips and tricks. And then once you've identified your population structure, you investigated, you're sure that this is the correct number of contributing ancestries, you then can go on and infer the local ancestry, and then also generate your global ancestry proportions with RFMX. So yeah, it just contains, you convert to VCF files, you run RFMX, you collapse it into the bed files, and then you visualize your karyograms. So this is just a nice summary of how you kind of would do that and go about it. And each step is dependent on the previous one. So it's important when you start to just keep track of everything and just be reminded that local ancestry is a little bit tricky, takes a lot of computing power, and there is still some gaps in terms of software development for actually visualizing some of these karyograms. So it's just important in terms of time-wise for your own projects to know that this might take some time. Okay, and now I'm just going to show you some illustrations of how the data looks like. Okay, I just want to share my screen again. This one. Okay, so from the previous work, we've did basically the prune data or looked at the CV value. So I don't know if someone actually want to comment on which K value is the correct one. Looking at this output file and the CV errors from, or like K equals from 2 to 5. So just looking at those values and actually picking the best one. So any guesses? Yes, that's correct. So 3 is the one with the smallest cross-validation. So that's why that we know is basically the correct number of contributing ancestries. So now you can actually go back, run admixture again, or you can just plot basically K equals 3 with your Pong. So if you don't want to have a messy k equals 2 to 5, you can just go and then map your specific k equals 3. Okay, and I don't know if anyone has any questions up until this point. So I hope everyone was able to generate Pong visualization, didn't have any problems with that. And then we can move on to RFMix. No online problems. I'm just going to my ECF files to show you actually how the different files needs to look like for running RFMix. Seem to me it's bit files. Oh, it's on the other one, sorry. Okay, so just to give you, like they said, a quick start. So like I said, this is first of all, you need a query VCF file, a reference file, a sample map, a genetic map. So I'm just going to show you how these files look like so that you can kind of get an idea of how they would be looking like, and then also how we would plot then a cariogram at the end. Did I put the sample map? There we go. Okay, so first, this is how the sample map would look like. So this is basically the individuals. You will see there's now a zero in front of the names, but this is kind of how the output VCF file looked like. That's actually your first column of your FAM file that didn't have any names. So then the VCF automatically just put a zero there. So just something to be cautious of. Sometimes this does happen. So that's why you need to recheck your files the whole time. So the first column is basically your ID from your FAM file. And then once again, you just indicate which ancestry is that, so that obviously the software knows when it reads your VCF file, which ones are basically your admix or reference. And yeah, so it can actually do that. And then you have your target samples or individuals. So this is the 14 individuals of interest we're looking at specifically. So you're just indicating literally a nice just file of list of that. And then you have your reference individuals. So that's a little bit more, obviously. So that's basically, you extract then, I already did this on the CHPC because unfortunately, it's a little bit too large to run on a local computer. I tried to run RFMix on my Mac and it just didn't want to do that. Since we need a lot of space, or RFMix use a lot of space to actually generate those intermediate files, and then it just doesn't want to do it. So we've kind of started doing it on the CHPC, but it's taking a really long time. So we've already kind of extracted the reference and the target populations from one another. So if I go look at the target one, there should just be basically 14 individuals in there. So just to quickly show you how it looks like. So you can see there's a lot fewer individuals in the header. So that's just 14 individuals. So that's going to be your input. So a basic command for running RFMix is basically looking like this. So this is the codes that I basically use to convert the VCF tools, or the used VCF tools, to first extract the reference individuals from our concatenated VCF file, from which you downloaded from the imputation server, and then also the target individuals. And then this is basically the code that you use to run RFMix. Like I said, unfortunately, I won't be able to show it on my laptop now, but what we are going to do is once all the files run on our CHPC, we will make a video to actually afterwards send to you guys to explain each step then. So it's just running a little bit longer than expected. And also you will be unable to run it on your own computer. Otherwise it's going to take forever. So we're waiting for that to run. So we will send out a recorded video of actually finishing this. And then just to explain the command is, obviously you've downloaded the RFMix, so you're going to call on RFMix. You give it the the target population first, and then the reference population, your sample map, your genetic map that you also need to generate, indicating the difference position, and the chromosome start position, end position. And then we're going to use four threads to run this. And then the generations, this G indicates how many generations back that you think admixture occurred. So how many generations of admixture subsequently. The default is 8, but you can specify it based off of previous literature. So you need to go read up on what happened previously with your populations when the estimated time of admixture occurred. And then the E is just indicating the number of iterations. So we want to run this 3 times. And then you get your output file and then also your chromosome. What's nice about RFMX is you, with this chromosome, you can actually specify the genomic region as well. So if you go into chromosome 1, but you just want to look at a very small position, you can actually indicate it here at this chromosome. So that's what's nice. You don't have to run the whole chromosome. And then we use this reanalyze reference, because sometimes your reference populations you include is admixed also. So then it just styles the algorithm that you can expect that the reference is also admixed. And then it just reanalyzes some of the reference samples, or when it's uncertain, then it reanalyzes. So it's just the extra step of why we actually include this. So yes, you have a question. No, you can go back a while. So this is actually on their page, RFMX page. They actually specify it here how you can do that. You actually give the genetic position itself. Wait, that's pretty base pairs. We'll get it now. It is somewhere there. Yeah. Oh, yes, here you go. So here you can see analyze range. There it gives the optional kind of how you want to do that and how many mega base pairs you want to include. So it's nice that that's why the manual is quite give you all the extra options as well if you want to indicate extra stuff that you don't necessarily would do with default parameters. Okay. So now we have a example file of how this collapse MSP bed files would look like. Just to show you, because since we don't have it right now, just show you an example of how it would look like. So here we have two individuals. So we're going to first look at the one allele. So this is basically the first column is basically giving you the chromosome, the start position, the end position, that specific ancestry for that as well. And this is, I couldn't quite remember what this was. I think it's also the start and end position of the specific SNP. Or it gives you also the switch points between when it switches between the one ancestry and the other one for the specific allele. So if you go down, you can see already for some of the regions, it's East Asian, Bantu speaking African, and you can see how it switches over for each genetic region, which is quite interesting. So this is just for the one allele. So that's how you kind of know for this position, chromosome 1, we know this is, it's going to be East Asian ancestry. And then if we look at the other bed file or allele, we can see it also has similar kind of ancestry, but it's already looking different. So a lot more Khoisan for the one allele than for the other one. And then you start seeing European. So it's quite interesting to see how the two alleles already for the same positions are different. And this is just for one individual. So this is just a nice way of knowing how the bed files should look like if you want to plot it. So now, as like I said, we use this plot choreogram Python script to actually visualize these choreograms. So the input, if I just quickly explain this, the input is first your first bed file here. The second command is the other bed file for the other allele. You specify the individual and the chromosome if you just want to look at one chromosome, but it's advisable to look from chromosome 1 to 22. And then you also have the centromeres. So we use a centromeres bed file to indicate that where in your genetic map is basically the centromere. So that's also something you need or require. And then you have your population order as well. And then you can also indicate colors. And then you specify your output file to get your final kind of plot or choreogram. So that's what's very satisfying about this is you worked first with your plink files, you did the ancestry inference, and now you can actually visualize it and it tells you a story. So like I said, we will run our example files on RFMX. It's just still running on the CHPC because it takes, like I said, a lot of computational power. And then we will post that video with all the getting the MSP files, collapsing it into bed files with all the commands for you at a later stage when that is done. So we don't want you to waste your time on your own laptop and then it doesn't work. So, and you do want to have kind of all the scripts and all the steps to still do it, to be able to do it. Okay. Yes. No, so that's why, yeah, everyone will be able to download this centromere file. I don't know. Yeah, so this is the build 37 because we know our data is on the reference data is on the build 37. Oh, wow, it says business is power directory. 19. I just want to read it now. Okay. Some reason doesn't want to open. But yeah, you can be able to download this centromere file very easily. I can do that, yeah. So we, like I said, we do have a GitHub page, TBO's Genetics, that I've also put in the slides where you can go and like see each step, step by step, with all the Python scripts, with all the steps and so on. I don't know why it doesn't want to plot actually now. I just want to see from my previous commands. There we go. It's giving me an error message now. Yeah, wait. Come on. Why is my pointer not going to work? Hello, giving us a problem. Oh, no, there still is. That still wants to is. Yeah. Arguments is not none. Okay, yeah, so it requires colors. Sorry, I just want to quickly see if I can put colors in and see if it wants to actually do what I wanted to do. No? I thought I was continuing to be. Oh, okay. Sorry, I'm does it want one argument? Okay. Nope. But yeah, I don't know if we want to do anything else. I think it's maybe the big bomb and the individual. Good job.
Okay, I think we are done with the local ancestry. The script that we're currently doing to plot, currently using to plot the karyogram, as is the case for most bioinformatics, has an error in it. So what we'll do is we'll make sure when we do the video detailing the local ancestry steps, using the input files or using the files that we've generated in the workshop, we will ensure that this does work. I'm sure it's just a comma or a space or apostrophe that is missing. So what we are going to do now is those of you who have been able to or unable to plot during Pong, using Pong, we'll be around to assist you with that. If necessary, what we will also do is if you were able to download your files from TopMed and would like to start with RFmix, we will also be around to assist you with that process if you're able to install RFmix on your computer. So we are going to be ending a little bit earlier, and we have sent around the OneDrive link to all the folders, and if someone does not have this link, please let us know, give us your email, and we will ensure that you have access to this. We will also ensure that the OneDrive is sorted so that we it's easier for you to know what files go where and the order of everything. And if you have a project that's currently going on using this information, using these scripts, and something is not clear or something is not working specific to your project, feel free to reach out to any of us and we will try and assist you as much as we can. We also please ask that you fill in the two polls that we sent around earlier. It's earlier on in the chat. Those people in person, please also remember to do that, and online. And we will be around, as I said, for until 2 o'clock to answer any questions. But if you don't want to hang around, by all means, thank you everybody for attending the workshop, and we hope that it was useful to you. We, as alluded to in the poll, we will be offering a more advanced, more detailed workshop using the skills that we've learned here and implementing it in a analysis, whether it be association, PRS, admixture mapping, or such. So please indicate your interest, if any, in that workshop, also in the poll. Okay, thank you everybody, and I hope you have a good afternoon. Thank you again for attending.
Okay, so hello everyone. I will just continue the kind of workshop, RFmix local ancestry inference. So just want to finish up this video for you guys. So unfortunately, like I said, the files were huge after importing it to imputation and actually downloading it down. So I'm just going to continue where you actually downloaded the VCF files from the Sanger imputation server. And then you did some post QC on the different VCF files. And here you can see I did that on the CHPC as well. And then afterwards, what you can do after post QC, you can concatenate these different VCF files from chromosome 1 to 22 into one specific VCF file. So this was quite big. So like I said, please, this is preferable if you do this on a high performance cluster or on a server and not on your local computer. So you can keep them separate, but I will, for this purposes, just keep the different VCF files separate. So I will also make all these commands available to you online and after this video as well. So afterwards, you've downloaded, you did the post QC on the VCF files, Now you actually want to separate the VCM, the target individuals, from your reference individuals. So that's what I basically did. So these individuals now have only your target individuals, which is the 14 individuals. And then you have your reference as well. So this is a very simple command where you use VCF tools and where you use the tag keep the reference individuals, where you just indicate the IDs of the reference individuals and the target individuals. I also post that on the documentation. And then now you have your target individuals and your reference individuals. This is the two files that RFMX requires. The other file that RFMX requires is a sample map. So the sample map is, I will show you now, is a very simple workshop. Sample map. So now you can see this is the specific ID and the specific ancestry. So that's the sample map. And then you also do require a genetic map. And how the genetic map also looks like is, for instance, chromosome 1, I think that's genetic map. So for chromosome 1, you will see this, the chromosome 1 in the first line, and then the actual position, and this is the recombination rate. So this is kind of the format the genetic map also looks. So that's the four input files that you require for RFMX to actually run. So the other commands that's part of RFMX, I will now show to you. So first, we're going to do a for loop for chromosome 1 until 22, and we're going to call on RFMX the software. We're going to input the target file, VCF file. We're going to input the reference file and then the sample map like I showed you now, and then also the genetic map. So these commands, the N4 actually indicates the number of threads you're going to use. And then also the G is basically the number of generations that since the admixture occurred, like I said, you use previous literature to actually indicate the specific number. The default is 8. And then the E is basically the number of iterations. This is the output file name you want to output. And this is the chromosome you're investigating. And then this is the place where you can actually just look at chromosome 1, 2, or just specify a specific region. In megabase pairs. The RFMX manual will kind of also explain this a little bit better, but it's cool because you can actually just do RFMX for a specific genetic region and not all chromosome 1 to 22. So that's the flexibility you do have with RFMX. So then you also have the reanalyze reference tag, just because you sometimes do have admixed reference individuals. So just to tell them, just reanalyze the reference if it's not completely 100% sure to which the target individuals match the reference individuals. So now you have the input like the input of the RFMX command. Like I said, we will make this command also available. So you have your four input files. You have your target file, VCF file, your reference VCF file, your sample map, and your genetic map. And then this, if you run the command, you will get the four output files. Like you can see, I have the four output files. Like I said, I'm just showing you this on the CHPC for purposes of it's that it's too big. So this is the four output files you will get from RFMX. So if you don't see one of these four files, you know something went wrong. So now for illustrative purposes, I will just now move to my local computer where you can actually plot this. So now you can see, like I said, we have the chromosome 22, the four different output files, just to show you that this is how each one looks like. So if you go to the RFMX Q file, the Q matrix one, you will see it looks very similar to admixture's output with the sample ID and the different global ancestry proportions for each individual in each column. So this is basically very similar to admixture output, but it's a little bit more accurate than the admixture output. The admixture was used to basically investigate the population structure first and to actually identify the correct number of ancestral reference populations that contributed to your population. So we usually use these global ancestry proportions in our statistical modeling and reporting also. So that's how the Q matrix look like. The forward backwards file is basically just giving you the posterior probabilities of each individual. So you can see here's the reference panel. We have our chromosome basically in the first column, the start position, and then the physical position, and then the posterior probabilities of each ancestry. But I think the next file will make things a little bit clearer. The MSP.TSV file is the one that we are going to use to actually plot our karyograms and going to modify a little bit. So if you look at the MSP.TSV file, Now you can see each subpopulation is coded as a specific number. So if you're Bantu Kenyan, you're naught. If you're Biaka Pygmy, you're one. When you're French, you're two, etc. So if you look at the itself, this is chromosome, the start position, end position. Once again, the start and end position of the recombination. And this is the number of SNPs that the ancestry is basically the same. So for 162 SNPs at that specific genetic region, the ancestry is basically the same for all the individuals. So this is basically what we call the ancestral aldi haplotype blocks that you do get. So you can see for the next one, for 105 SNPs, it's the same ancestry. So what's nice about this output is, first, you look at the first individual. So the one allele gets coded as naught and the other allele gets coded as one. So if you look for the first position for this individual, it's 1-1. So we know for the first position, this individual is basically homozygote for Biaka Pygmy. For the next position of the next individual, once again, also homozygote. If you look at the next individual, oh, now we can see this person is basically heterozygote. For first, they have one allele of a Mbuti Pygmy, and the other allele is basically a Biaka Pygmy. And so you can do that. So this is the file we will be using to actually plot the choreograms, but it needs some modifications to actually be able to be plotted. So I'm going to take you through that steps, and then also show you how to do that with the Python script. So that's the four output files. And now we're going to work with the msb.tsv file. First of all, what we want to do, I'm going to use a sed command to cut out the first two lines of this file, the msb.tsv file. And then we're going to just call them a temporary file for chromosome 22. So if we're going to look at now the temporary file, chromosome 22, now you can see the first two headers is basically cut out. So now we're just interested in one individual. So we're just interested in this one individual for now to be able to plot, and we're going to need this first 5 columns as well to be able to plot. So I'm going to show you now further how to do that. Like I said, I will make all these commands available to you. So what we want to do is basically print, take out with the OR command, the first 5 columns. So this is what this basically tells you with an OR command, is to just print out the first 5 columns, and then we're not interested in the number of SNPs it's going to repeat. And then we have basically the chromosome column 7 and 8 for the allele from the one individual and allele from the other individual. So then we're going to also put that in a temporary file. So if we look at this temp2 file now, you will see that we have the chromosome, the start position, the end position, and then the start and end position of the recombination, and then the first two alleles of that, or the first columns of that first individual. So now it's not completely in the correct format yet. We need to take this node 1, 2, or 3 of each ancestry and actually replace it with that specific name. So to be able to do that, we're first going to print out the last 2 columns and put it into one specific file. So that's where you can see we only have those 2. And then we're going to print out the first 5 columns so that we can actually paste it later. So now what we're going to do is we're going to actually replace the different numbers with a specific name. And the command I use for this is the sed command. So now we're going to take this file we have, replace every naught with a Bantu Kenya. We're going to replace every one with a Biaka Pygmy. We're going to replace every 2 with a French. And then we're going to replace the 3 and so on for each number, and then save it into a specific file. So now if we're going to look at this file, you will see now each number has a specific ancestry. So the last thing we want to do is we just want to make the file complete by merging it again with the first 5 columns. So now we have the first with the third one. Then we want to call it a specific name. So we want to use this to plot. So if we're going to look at this plot orphomix file, now you will see nicely this final file also is very nice to just investigate or look for instance chromosome 22 at this specific position. We want to know what's the ancestry. And what's interesting, now you can see this specific individual is heterozygote for a Mbuti Pygmy and a Bantu Kenya. So they got a different ancestry from, they got this allele from a different ancestry at that specific genetic position. So this is also what local ancestry is very handy for, or what orphomics is really nice to do, is you can actually see at each specific genetic region, you can have the specific ancestry. So it's not like global ancestry proportions where you just have like a 50% global ancestry or African or European ancestry. You can actually now pinpoint each specific genetic region, what is that ancestry. And like I said, some of them you can see as homozygote, and other regions, once again, like here you can see it's heterozygote, French and Mbuti Pygmy. So even though you don't plot, you're not even plotting the choreograms, you can still use this file to actually know the specific ancestry at a specific region. So now I will show you how to be able to plot this file and just make a nice visualization of this information. So once again, we're going to split the two alleles from each other. So with this command, so first we're going to make the first allele. So first what this command says is we're going to print out the first three columns, and then the sixth column, and then the fourth and the fifth, and then make this the first allele. So this is the individual we're looking at, and this is A indicates the first allele. So if we're going to look at this individual now, you will see they have the chromosome, the beginning position, the end position, the specific ancestry, and then also the recombination rate for that. So this is now the one allele we have, and now we need to do that for the second allele. So obviously one person has two alleles at each specific genetic position. So this is what we're going to call B, and this is column seven. So that's the second column. So now you can see this is the second allele we're looking at. So now we have the two alleles of that person. And now we're going to plot it with a plot choreogram. So this is the plot choreogram point pi, which we will also will give you. And then also you will need to have a centromeres bed file. And this how this centromeres bed file looks like is just giving from chromosome 1 till like 22, and it also includes the X chromosome, which is 23. It just indicates the different switch points and where the centromeres basically are in the genetic region. So we will also provide this for you. So for the input for actually making the choreograms, control L, what we will be needing is the two allele or bed files. You will need the centromeres bed file, and you will need the plot choreogram Python. So the problem is with this Python script, it requires Python 2.7. So this was written a while back and it was not updated. So what we're going to do is, what I usually do is I create a Conda environment where I activate Python 2.7 and then I run the script and then I deactivate it again. So what I'm going to just show you how we do this. So I'm just going to list all my Conda environments I have, like I said. This is now the base one where we're at. You can use Python 3.7 or Python 2.7. So I want the Python 2.7, so I'm going to activate that. Conda activate, and then you need to write out Python 2.7. And now you can see we're using Python 2.7 now. So now we can actually plot this choreogram, because unfortunately, this code was written only in Python 2.7. So now we know Python 2.7 is there. We're going to plot the choreogram. We're going to use that. And then the first indication what you're going to do is we're going to indicate the bed file. This is the input. If you open up the actual script, you will see this is the input it requires. So bed A. So now bed A is basically the first allele of the individual we made. And then the second part is the other allele. So the file. So this is the two bed files, alleles that you want to give in as an input. And then what we're going to do is we want the individual name to be printed out. Then you need to indicate the centromeres, and then the actual centromere file. And then you can also indicate the population order. Like I said, we will give these commands in a separate file. This is just for illustrative purposes. Then we have the population order. So you can have this basically in any format you want, but I just chose a random order. So just indicating the different ancestries you're going to include, which is a comma separated list, and remember to give the apostrophes because otherwise it would not read it. Then you can also indicate the different colors, and then you can use the Python different codes, which uses a hexadecimal to actually indicate the different colors. you can find this online as well. And then the output is basically, it will give you, you can also use other names or colors, but this is a nice color scheme that you can get online with different shades of pink or blue or whatever. So this is then the final output file or indicating which kind of, so this is basically the command to be actually be able to take these two bait files you have for each individuals of that local ancestry information and use this Python script to plot it and then output a specific picture. So this is what's going to make the nice choreograms you see. So yeah, let's enter and see, hopefully it works. And then I will show you, yes, now we know, okay, great, it ran. We have the PNG. So now if we go to the documents and we go to the specific place where I actually made it, there we go, see. And now you can see, nice, for this individual, we've plotted chromosome 22. It gives you the positions and genetic positions in base pairs. Each individual has a different color. Like I said, you can change this population order around. You can change the colors. Now we've only looked at chromosome 22 just for to just save some memory on my laptop. But like I said, you can do it from chromosome 1 to 22. You can only visualize chromosome 8. And I think this is what's very nice about this choreogram is if you only want to also showcase chromosome 15, a specific region, you can also do that. Or you can plot chromosome 1 to 22. So you can actually take now your files you have, which you've uploaded to the imputation server, download all of them, split the VCF files into reference and target, run RFMX on all chromosome 1 and 22, take the MSP file, do this for all the MSP files, transform it the way I did, and then plot it. So this is the final step in our analysis. And like I said, this is the nice way to visualize this. And in the end, you can use basically this file to actually be able also to include or just look at the local ancestry at specific regions. So yeah, this is the end of the local ancestry. And also, if you do have any questions, please let me know. And then also, we will upload all these files for you onto the OneDrive and as well with this video and the different commands in a separate page or documentation. And I will encourage you to please upload your VCF files, and when you're running RFMX or admixture, to actually try and do this on a server or on a CHPC or high performance cluster, just because of the amounts of data that you use, because I don't know which data you're going to use. And I would suggest to play around with it, because it's interesting to see if you change the population orders or if you change the number of reference individuals you've included. I hope this video helps, and this concludes then the local ancestry inference part.